Ramen S. He completed his undergraduate studies from Thyagarajar College of Engineering. He pursued architecture with almost 5 years of practice and allied 3 years of professional architectural photography. He worked as an architect for Studio Kriya Architects Private Limited, which is a part of TVH Housing, Chennai. And he also worked for the architectural design group, ADG, headed by A.R. Dhanasekaran, Chennai. He's also worked for many other organizations like Design Cube Architects, Carvin Design Consultants, and AIM Associates previously.
Welcome to UGC Lecture Series for B Architecture. And this is Building Materials 3, AR6304. So, we're talking about materials mainly that go into most familiar forms of construction. And in this Building Materials 3, we talk about concrete, we talk about finishes, we talk about other elements which go into construction. In this particular lecture, we'll be talking about the constituents of concrete. We talked about cement in the previous lecture. So, this is Unit 1, Requirements of Ingredients for Mortar Concrete, Part 2, Lecture 2. So, as I said, we talked about cement. Cement is the binding material which acts as a constituent that binds two or other materials and makes a composite concrete. So, what does cement bind? So, cement exactly binds three materials which you must be familiar by now, which is used to make concrete: sand or fine aggregates, coarse aggregates, and of course, water. Water is what adds the chemical, creates or initiates the chemical reaction of these materials with the help of cement. So, with respect to each constituent material, we talk about their sources, we talk about the classification, we talk about tests, and we talk about the various applications and the various ways it affects the characteristics of concrete as a final unit. So, as I said, we talk about sand, coarse aggregates, and water. We'll deal with sand first. Sand is nothing but naturally occurring granular material composed of finely divided rock and mineral particles. So, sand, you've heard of sand from a very long time. So, if you thought about sand or where it originated, you can think about hunting of the pre-medieval man. He used arrows or spears. The way the arrows or spears were sharpened was with the use of sandstone, which is one of the ways of sharpening it. So, sand or sandstone was being used from a very long time. It evolved from being used for small purposes to the level of use of construction and domestic construction, and also to levels of bigger constructions. So, it is defined by the size being finer than gravel and coarser than silt. So, silt and sand are two different things completely. So, sand is something that you differentiate from silt. It should not be as fine as silt, nor should it be as coarse as gravel. Gravel is nothing but smaller particles of stone, which are broken stone kind of things. Sand can also refer to a textural class of soil or soil type. So, a soil containing more than 85% sand size particles by mass. The composition of sand varies depending on the local rock sources and conditions. So, sand is formed or is found in various places in various modes, in various forms, and is also formed by various methods. But the most common constituent of sand in inland continental settings and non-tropical coastal setting is silica. So, we talked about sand, which is nothing but silica, silicon dioxide or SiO2, usually in the form of quartz. So, this is basically what sand is. Moving on, sand is used as a fine aggregate. I talked about concrete having fine aggregates, coarse aggregates and water. So, sand constitutes the fine aggregate. It is a granular form of silica. Sand used for mixed design is known as standard sand. So, we move on to technical terms in terms of construction. We have cement, which is called as Portland cement. Sand will be referred to as standard sand. The most important or most common source of sand in India is from Tamil Nadu. It's called Ennore sand. Though it is being depleted in large numbers, it is considered as a standard sand for use of construction. Standard sand should be obtained from Ennore, Tamil Nadu. It should be quartz, light gray or whitish variety, and should be free from silt. As I said, silt and sand are two different things. Presence of a lot of silt in sand can ruin the concrete formation and thus the whole construction unit. It should 100% pass through 2 mm IS sieve and should be 100% retained on 90 micron IS sieve. So, these are two limits of extremes for which sand should pass through. So, we move on to sources. Sources of sand can be natural and artificial. Any material in general are either found naturally or created artificially. So sand again as well is either natural or artificial. The most common sources of natural sand can be classified into river sources and non-river sources. So as I said, sand can be found in various modes, it can be found in various places and it can be found at different times. So this is basically classified into river sources and non-river sources. So river is a flowing water body as we all know, it flows from frozen form to that of the ocean. So while it moves on, it basically treads on land. So it changes the form of land into coarse aggregates, into rocks, into sand particles finally. So river sources of sand are that run in channel and off channel. So sand can be from the main channel or under the channel or the channel aside it. In channel sources that run in stream and off channel sources include floodplain sand, terrace sand and paleo sand. So floodplain sand is nothing but water washes over and leaves a layer of sand or silt from which sand can be obtained. Then there is also terrace sand which forms various levels of sand and paleo sand which is a residual of rock formation. So we move on, non-river sources are mostly just land and offshore sources and are contributed from dunes, pits and beaches. So any other source of sand other than river or related to the water body or the water body movement is called sources from the non-river sources. So they contribute dunes. So sand basically found in desert, many pits and beaches are the other forms of sand. Lakes, lagoon and backwater sands are also an important source. Reservoir sand is also an important source. So these are all non-river sources. We move on to artificial sources which include methods by which sand can be manufactured. As I said, any material can either be found naturally or can be created manually. So it can be made from primary aggregates or secondary aggregates. So sand, you need a primary aggregate or a secondary aggregate. So sand is either made from crushing a basic form of raw material or it can be used by secondary materials which is recycled to form sand. So sand from primary aggregates is simply manufactured sand and one from secondary is recycled sand. So it can be classified as manufactured sand and recycled sand. So classification of sand. Sand, as I said, is formed in various modes, found in various places. Accordingly, it's also classified. Sand may be classified on the basis of source, mineralogical composition, size of the particles and particle size distribution. Depending upon the source, sand may be classified as natural sand, as I said, and artificial sand. Natural sand is formed by natural disintegration of rocks or which are deposited by streams. So, as I said, water moving creates a lot of differences on the rocks or the nearby layers of rocks formed. So, what we find is crushed stone sand produced by crushing hard stones and crushed gravel sand produced by crushing natural gravel. So, these are two ways in which natural sand is formed. Based on mineralogical composition, sand is divided into quartz, feldspar and carbonaceous varieties. So, these are different varieties based on the chemical compounds or the minerals present in it. Depending upon its size, sand is classified as coarse sand, fineness modulus, medium sand and fine sand. So, even in sand which is actually a fine aggregate, there are various levels of fineness with which it can be classified. So, as for any material to have a good quality for construction, we need to have tests for those particular materials. So, in case of sand, organic impurities test is an important test. So, sand is classified or taken apart as small capacities and then each is tested for impurities because sand has this characteristic of having distribution of the various materials it can be mixed with. So, silt content test. So, as I said, silt and sand are two different things. Having too much of silt in sand could make the concrete or the material that is being formed with sand too much of a plastic material. Particle size distribution. This test can be conducted at site or in laboratory for every 40 cubic meter. So, as I said, sand again is divided into different batches and the particle size distribution is determined. Bulking of sand. So, bulking of sand is an important characteristic. This has to be tested compulsory for each batch of sand. So, this test is conducted at site for every 20 cubic meter of sand. Based on bulking of sand, suitable water cement ratio is calculated for concrete at site. So, we'll go on and explain what bulking of sand is. So, the increase in moisture of sand increases the volume of sand. So, let us say you have sand, you add water, what happens is the volume of sand increases. So, what happens in detail is every sand particle when it comes in contact with water becomes attached to water and hence the volume of the sand is increased. So, overall the actual volume of sand increases. The concern here is that sand which is actually lesser in volume when added to water becomes a bigger volume, which means that it is actually lesser in size but is shown higher because of water. This is called as bulking of sand. So, each batch of sand has to be tested for bulking of sand such that the volume is not mistaken. The reason is that moisture causes film of water around sand particles which results in the increase of volume of sand. So, for moisture content percentage of 5 to 8%, there will be an increase in volume up to 20 to 40% depending upon sand. So, there is a very drastic influence on this sand and its volume. If the sand is more fine, there will be more increased volume. This is known as bulking of sand, which is what I explained. The moisture content of sand is increased by adding more water. The sand particles pack near each other and the amount of bulking of sand is decreased. So, it helps in determining the actual volume of sand. So, this is how bulking of sand is actually tested, and thus the volume of sand is actually determined. So, you can see a small quantity of sand is enough to carry out this test. We move on in detail about the impurities. So, we have this impurities for test for impurities. We talk about the impurities in detail now. Impurities such as clay, dust and organic materials are harmful for mortar and concrete, and in any case should not exceed 4%. So, as I said, for any building material, the allowable or minimum extent of impurities is always stipulated such that it does not exceed it. So, in this case for sand, which is a very, very fine material, clay, which is an even finer material, dust and organic materials are harmful. So, these are the impurities that we need to be cautious about, and their minimum extent which is allowable is 4% in the whole amount of sand. Clay is the most harmful since it contains individual sand particles and prevents their bonding with cement. So, once clay comes in contact with sand, it bonds with sand before cement can, and thus makes it difficult for cement to bond with it. The clay and dust impurities can be removed by careful washing. So, this is a way of separating the clay from the sand. What is interesting is we can use this particular disadvantage of clay attaching to sand and create another form of concrete. Addition of finely ground clay to clean coarse sand. So, we have various forms of sand. So, adding clean coarse sand to finely ground clay can improve its grading and reduce voids. So, this particular disadvantage of clay attaching to sand can be used, and this reduces voids. So, this a lean mortar deficient in fines, which is fines aggregate, may be improved both in density and workability by addition of small percentage of such clay. The quality of sand, which is what we have been testing. Like any other material, there are certain features that determine the quality of sand. Good quality of sand should not possess more than 4% of silt content. So, as I said, 4%, that minimal amount should be maintained. It should have natural and crushed stone sand. It must be free from organic matter and other dirt particles. To the end of sand as fine aggregates, we move on to coarse aggregates. Coarse aggregates are nothing but the gravel. We talked about cement, which is the binder for all these composite materials. Fine aggregates, which we just discussed, and now coarse aggregates. So, we have bigger stone size, rock size particles and smaller fine sand, and then we have water, which is what induces or initiates the reaction between cement and these aggregates. So, the last fine aggregates and now coarse aggregates. The sources of coarse aggregates are uncrushed gravel or stone, results from natural disaggregation of rock. So, rock, which is the basis of both sand as well as coarse aggregates. Crushed gravel or stone, it results from crushing of gravel or hard stone. Partially crushed gravel or stone, it is a product of blending of the above two aggregates. So, we looked at sand. Sand has extremes. So, there are various types of sand according to the various sieves it can pass through. Similarly, coarse aggregates too have their different classifications based on their sizes. So, classification, as I said, nearly all natural aggregate originate from bedrocks. We have natural aggregates or artificial aggregates. There are three kinds of rocks which are natural aggregate originations: igneous, sedimentary and metamorphic rocks. We must have heard about it from a lot of sources. The many property of coarse aggregates are dependent on the characteristics of the parent rock itself. So, when you talk about coarse aggregates which give a characteristic strength to concrete, is actually dependent on the parent rock from which it is formed. Furthermore, the coarse aggregates can be classified into two distinct types: single size aggregates and graded aggregates. As the name implies, the aggregates can be classified into: one is the single size aggregates, such that every aggregate, coarse aggregate in this particular constituent material concrete is of single size, and the other is a combination of the various single size aggregate types. Single size aggregates have components which 80 to 100% of them pass through specific sieve. So, that is a way of classifying each single aggregate, and graded aggregates may have more than one single size aggregates. So, we looked at the sources and the classification. Now, we will move further to the properties which add to the characteristics of coarse aggregates. So, we will be briefly talking about the size of coarse aggregates, the shape of coarse aggregates and the grading of the aggregates. So, what does size do to the aggregates and its characteristics? So, size of gravel affects mainly the strength and workability. So we talked about cement as well as concrete. Workability and its strength are two important characteristics. This is directly affected by the size of gravel. I'll tell you how that works, because gravel, the bigger the size, the better its ability to form compact binding material forms. So this adds to the strength and workability. The use of large maximum size can be used in practical conditions, and they help in reducing the cement content. So apart from being able to form locked forms, they reduce the cement content being used, they reduce the water being used, and also reduce the dry shrinkage. So when concrete is formed, the one of the properties or the characteristic that it shows is the dry shrinkage. This can be reduced with the varying sizes of the gravel. Another important aspect to consider with size of gravel is the maximum size of aggregate should not be greater than 1/4 the size of structural member. Let's say we are forming a structural unit or a construction unit. The size of the aggregate should not be 4 times smaller than the whole size of the masonry unit, because this will make it very brittle. So that is an important thing to watch out for. We move on to the shape of gravel. It is vital property of affecting workability of fresh concrete and also its strength and durability. So this also affects the workability, it affects the strength and also the durability. The parent rock is again the cause of the shapes of aggregates and also their formation over a period of time. According to shape aggregate, it is classified as rounded aggregate, irregular, angular, flaky aggregate, elongated aggregate and flaky elongated aggregate. So the last three aggregates do not exactly form a good set of concrete forming materials, but the first three, rounded, irregular and angular, have different ways of adding different types of strength to concrete. We move on to gradation. Particle size distribution of the various aggregates is called gradation. So as simple as that, sieve analysis is conducted to determine the gradation. We talked about it before. Grading pattern is arrived by sieving sample through successive sieves. The aggregate retained on each sieve is thus graded. So gradation is an important factor affecting the workability. So workability, as we talked about, is how we set, handle or harden a particular concrete structural unit. So this is affected by the gradation. Proper gradation ensures that a sample contains all necessary aggregates to maintain concrete quality. So the quality of concrete is maintained by having all the necessary aggregates in correct proportions. So gradation is an important factor which adds to this. So sampling, this is nothing but testing the coarse aggregates. Coarse aggregates need not be tested in very complicated method, it just has to be sampled. Can be sampled directly in case of the belt samples or direct stockpile sampling. You can go check it out in the direct stockpiles. It can also be checked out in bins and discharge bins. Some of the tests that can be done for coarse aggregates are sieve test, gravity and absorption test, besides the direct sampling. So we've gone through cement, we've done sand and we've done coarse aggregates. Now we talk about water, which is what initiates the reaction with cement, which in turn binds the other two composite materials. So initially we talk about the sources of water that are useful for drinking. So drinking water is actually the water that is suitable for construction. One might think if any impure water or maybe even slightly contaminated water can be used for concrete making, but it is not the case. We'll look at why. Potable water or drinking water is considered suitable for concrete making. 97% of the water on earth is salt water and only 3% is fresh water. So salt water, saline water is not actually used for making concrete. So fresh water is the main constituent. Sources of fresh water include surface water and off surface water. Surface water in the form of river, lake or freshwater wetland. Surface water is naturally replenished by precipitation and naturally lost through discharge to ocean, evaporation, transpiration and groundwater recharge. The other sources being groundwater, under river flow and frozen sources. So these are natural sources of water. Water serves the following purpose. So what does water do, or in the process of concrete making, where is water used? That is what we're going to be looking at. So it actually has three important requirements. It wets the surface of aggregates. So that is what it does first. It does it to develop the adhesion, because the cement paste adheres quickly and satisfactory to the wet surface of the aggregates than to a dry surface. So adding water makes cement immediately attach itself to the binding material. So that is one first thing that the water starts. To prepare a plastic mixture of various ingredients and to impart workability to concrete. So apart from initiating the cement to bind these materials, in order to be able to use the cement more plastically or in a more workable condition, water is necessary. The final part where it is necessary is needed for the hydration of cementing materials. So what happens is, after cement binds, it releases heat, or hydration of cement is what occurs. This is the most important part of concrete formation, where the actual cement and the concrete set or harden. So there are also various ways of testing the water. Most tests are actually lab tests, but there are also other simple tests. The quantity of water in the mix plays a vital role in the strength of concrete. Some water which may have adverse effect on hardened concrete sometimes may not be harmless or even beneficial during mixing. So, as I said, mostly drinking water is used, but in some cases impurities can be beneficial. So, clear distinction should be made between the effect on hardened concrete and the quality of mixing water. So, going through the mixing of quality of water is an important factor. The common specification regarding quality of water is that it should be fit for drinking. Such water should have inorganic solid less than 1000 ppm. So, inorganic solid, the various impurities, the color, the smell, the pH value is all an important factor, and it all has to be maintained according to the following limited specification, such that it can be used in a most effective form. Some water which are not potable, as I mentioned exceptions, may be used in making concrete without any significant effect or impact. Dark color or bad smell water may be used if they do not possess deleterious substances. So, not having too much suspended solids can be acceptable in case the dark color or bad smell is not present. pH of water to even around 9 is allowed if it does not taste brackish. So, usually pH of 7 is what is actually best for concrete making, but it is extended up to a level of 9. In coastal areas where local water is saline and have no altered sources, the chloride concentration up to 1000 ppm is even allowed for drinking. So, in some cases, as I said, where are exceptions of conditions of the construction conditions present, what we could do is we could allow it to some extent. This excessive amount of alkali carbonates and bicarbonates in some natural mineral water may cause alkali silica reaction. So, this can affect to an extent, but is acceptable in case of the conditions set by the site. So, as I said, there are some specifications for water. So, a limit of acidity to neutralize 200 ml sample of water, use in phenolphthalein as indicator. It does not require more than 2 ml. The limit of alkalinity is determined. The limit of solids, as I said, is also determined. So, these are some ways in which the quality and the basic characteristic of water can be tested. With that, we come to the end of the various constituent materials of concrete formation. We will further move on to how concrete is made. So, in this particular lecture, we have understood what the components are that go into the making of concrete. So, we looked at cement, we looked at sand, we looked at coarse aggregates, and we looked at water. So, these four important things, apart from other materials which vary the different types of concrete making, are what basically constitute concrete. So, we looked at the sources, we looked at the classification, basic properties, the testing and quality of each of the components have been discussed. Studying the various properties of sand and its classification, we went through that to understand the characteristic the sand imparts to concrete. Studying the various properties of coarse aggregates, doing the same for concrete. Studying the sources and quality of water which bear an influential factor in the making and curing of concrete. So, after concrete formation, curing is an important process, we will talk about that. So, water is also important for that thing. Some exercises which you could try is attempting simple field test to test samples of sand. So, sand, you could try bulking of sand, you could try other sieve tests which are usually done in small domestic construction sites. Attempting simple field test to test samples of coarse aggregates, visiting a construction site. So, if you visit a construction site, you will see all the tests that we mentioned going on. This can be viewed and learned on site. Also, making a comprehensive list of the grades and standards one has to maintain to get best concrete in given set of practical conditions is essential. So, this is an exercise that you would also try. With this, we come to the end of this lecture. Thank you.